welcome back. It is the Vegas Take, Sharp and Shapiro. So glad you could join us on a Thursday. Loaded show, as I mentioned. Chris Wynn in studio, along with J.D. Sharp. I am Brian Shapiro. Just in a few minutes here, we're going to be joined by Dina Titus, Congresswoman here, and plenty of questions to get to her, that is for sure. And I believe we have her on the line now, if I'm not mistaken. So plenty of questions to get to the Congresswoman, Dina Titus. Dina, thank you so much for joining us on the line.
Well, thank you for having me.
Appreciate it. Always good to have you with us. Boy, do we have a lot to get to with you. Let me start with this. What was your first reaction when you heard about this airstrike and taking out General Soleimani? What was your first reaction to it, and how did you feel about it then, several days ago, and how do you feel about it now?
Well, I serve on the Foreign Affairs Committee, so we talk about these things often in the committee, have hearings on the situation in the Middle East. But this came as a surprise to me, just as it did to everybody else. You know, a lot of people in the Pentagon didn't know about it. Our allies mostly didn't know about it. Certainly Congress overall hadn't been informed about it. Mm-hmm. I was also had a feeling of concern, because when you do something that's this drastic, you can expect some follow-up from their side. And you know that Iran is a pretty uncertain, reckless kind of regime, that you don't know what they're going to do, but you can imagine that it's going to be bad.
Right.
And then finally, over time, as we've come to realize that it was done in a very reckless way on our side, because there's not been really any evidence of an imminent attack that
right.
was coming, that we were responding to. And here we were taking out a top official on the soil of an ally, something that previous presidents had determined would be too dangerous to do because it would put our troops in harm's way. Now it's gone from surprise to concern.
Congresswoman, let's talk a little bit about that alleged imminent threat, because I'm a little confused about this.
Are you there?
Yeah. Can you hear me, Dina? Dina, can you hear me? Did we lose her? Uh-oh. I think
Hello?
Dina, can you hear us okay? I don't know what just happened. That's bizarre. All right. Well, we'll get Dina Titus back on the line. That's unfortunate, because I certainly have a lot more questions I want to get to her. Let's try to hopefully get her back on the line.
But, Brian, she brings up a very interesting point, and that's been something that's been discussed the past couple of days, is the legality of the assassination of the general, right? Because we are talking about something that's going on foreign soil. It's not on American soil, and it's a member of the government that we are, for all intents and purposes, assassinating. And so that is a discussion that has been had, and that is going to continue to be had with respect to, you know, the general being taken out and being taken out in Iraq, as opposed to something that's done on American soil.
I'm very suspicious when it comes to all this stuff. I've heard a lot of conspiracy theories. I have no idea what's true or not. It could be possible, I guess, that the people in the Iranian government wanted this guy taken out. That could be possible. I don't know. I the response was certainly strange, in that I'm very happy that nobody lost their life. But with that being said, it appears to me, and I could be wrong on this, but it appears to me that the Iranians were working with the United States in this way, that they could have, and I say could, because we don't know for sure, could have warned the United States of these attacks. They could have.
Well, I mean, if they shot 30-plus ballistic missiles,
that they had to respond in some way.
Yeah, you're talking about the response, yeah.
No. Not only that, I think that the Iranians were working with the United States on assassinating Soleimani. I think that Soleimani was not liked as much as people say he was in his home country.
Listen, I put everything on the table at this point, and that is one of many possibilities here. To me, that's not out of the realm of possibilities. I believe we have the Congresswoman back on the line. Dina, can you hear us okay?
I can.
Great.
You just faded out. I don't know at what point in my answer I lost you.
No, so. We heard. We actually.
You heard me?
That's all right, Congresswoman.
We actually heard everything, and then my next question, I think that's when we lost you. So you were talking a little bit about the so-called alleged imminent threat. So let me ask you a little bit about this. Let's just say hypothetically that Osama bin Laden was taken out 2 days before the 9/11 attacks. I still believe, sadly, the 9/11 attacks would have been carried out, right? So if there was an imminent threat, wouldn't there still be an imminent threat, Dina?
Well, that is exactly the problem. General was immediately replaced by the person who had been right under him, and we don't know whether you can trust what Iran says when they say, well, we're done for now. Plus, even if the official government says they're done, the Iranian-backed militia have not responded, so we don't know what they're going to do. Mm-hmm. And, of course, our fight against ISIS now has been put on hold, so that's another dangerous element. And don't forget, the Iranians are moving forward now with the nuclear weapons program that right. had been kind of on hold. So, yes, it's still an imminent threat.
Have you received – I know that if you did receive some classified information, obviously we don't want you to share it with us. You cannot. But can you answer, have you received classified information? Have you spoken to some of your friends in Washington? Have you had those conversations? Has it changed anyone's mind?
Well, I've actually been in two classified briefings. One is a member of the Homeland Security Committee, and then one that was for all members of the House. There you had the Secretary of Defense, Secretary of State, the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs. So it was a very high-level briefing. I can't, you're right, tell you any of the specifics, but I can tell you that most members thought that it was insufficient and that we weren't really given any evidence like dates or targets
wow.
or the imminent threat.
You're telling me that in a classified briefing, you weren't giving any details as far as this imminent threat goes, as far as dates or locations? You're confirming that? Because I find that to be very troublesome.
Well, it is troublesome, and you know that you heard that Senator Lee, when he came out of his briefing on the Senate side, just saying that he was insulted. They were treated like children.
Wow.
We weren't given any information. And that was kind of the general feeling, is that, well, we didn't learn anything in here that we didn't know from the news.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to give you a hypothetical here, and I'm just throwing this out there. This is pure speculation on my part.
Okay.
Do you think there is any chance that the Iranians were working with the U.S. to take this general out, number one? And number two, do you think they gave the United States of America the locations in the response time, responding back, because they knew that if any Americans would be taken out, it would be very bad for them? Do you think there's any chance that that has taken place, or do you think that's just a conspiracy theory?
Well, I have not heard that. He is such a revered figure in Iran, number two in the government. You saw a million people turn out for the funeral.
Right.
So I can't imagine that they would be behind taking him out or working with the U.S. in that way. So we certainly haven't heard that as
okay.
a possibility.
Congresswoman, correct me if I'm wrong, but Soleimani was listed as an official terrorist by the United States. And in that case, the rules of engagement do not apply. Is that correct?
Well, it's very uncertain, and that's one of the things that we're looking at in Congress today. You know, we have an authorization to use force against terrorists in Iraq that goes back a number of years, and the president is still trying to use that to justify taking out an Iranian in Iraq. And mm-hmm. it's been a long time since that was put in place, and that's why we're going to vote today on a kind of a renewal of the War Powers Act and say you can't do any more action against Iran
gotcha.
Without coming to Congress.
That's good to
and
hear.
Would that be just Iran, or would that be any other country as well?
Well, this is going to be specific to Iran.
Okay.
But
gotcha.
I think that going forward, you're going to see Congress try to reassert itself, much as it did after the Vietnam War when it first passed the War Powers Act, mm-hmm. because over time, as the result of 9/11, the president has just assumed more and more power, and it's Congress who declares war, not the mm-hmm. president.
If you're just joining us, we're speaking with Congresswoman Dina Titus. Okay, Dina, let's move on to impeachment. Let's talk about Nancy Pelosi, if that's okay. It appears to me that there is some pressure that's mounting on Nancy Pelosi to transmit these impeachment articles. What is your opinion on that? When do you think she will do it?
Well, I think she's handled this masterfully, and she says she'll do it when she's ready. You can see that in the time she has held those articles, more information has come out, and I think that's the value of not rushing. You have had Bolton say that he will testify now if subpoenaed, and you've had more memos or email exchanges come out about those within the government and the Office of Management and Budget thinking that withholding those funds was illegal and how are they going to deal with it. So that certainly speaks to the cover-up aspect. So I think, she'll do it when she's ready. And we certainly don't want to just send something over that's going to be buried in McConnell's drawer or just brushed through.
Let's talk about him real quick, if that's okay. I am disgusted by Mitch McConnell's behavior, as I'm sure you are as well, and many Democrats are. You know, he shows up to the White House yesterday, has a private meeting with the president, says he's going to confer with the president when it comes to this impeachment stuff and when it comes to this trial in the Senate. What do you make of Mitch McConnell, his behavior, and his oath? Because it seems like he's broken that oath to the people of the United States of America. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I'm inclined to agree with you when you say that the whole process is going to be done in conjunction with the president's lawyers. That's not the way a trial is supposed to work. I mean, that prejudices the results before you even get started. You know, yesterday was the anniversary of the day that the Senate voted 100%, all 100 members, in agreement on the rules of the Clinton impeachment. And now look at what a difference you have in this situation. It's become so partisan.
Well, Dina, first of all, let me say I always appreciate it when you come on our show, and we appreciate your perspective as well, and your hard work. You've done a lot of great things in the state of Nevada and here in Las Vegas for sure. Always appreciate it when you take some time to join us. I would hope maybe a few weeks down the road we could have a little bit more time and we can get you back on because, boy, there's so much to talk about.
Well, let's do that because it's been quite a way to start the new year, and things change by the hour, so we will have a lot more to talk about in a week or so.
It does appear that way, Congresswoman. Again, thank you so much for your time, and maybe later this month we could have you on a little bit longer. Thank you so much.
Sounds good. Thank you.
All right, there you go. That's
thanks a lot, Congresswoman.
There you go. Dina Titus, Congresswoman. The most telling thing there in that interview, and then we got to take a break, is the fact that she has been in two private briefings in classified information that the president, his people have given to her and other members of Congress. And in those briefings and in those classified briefings, they did not give out any details on that quote-unquote imminent threat. She just said in that interview, which I think is extremely telling in some news that she broke, that they did not give any coordinates or any targets that Soleimani was going after. They didn't give any dates. If this was such an imminent threat, don't you think the president and his people would at least, at the very least, give out a few targets that the Iranians were going after? The fact that that information was not, forget about the public, I'm talking about to Congress, people that are in Congress, leads me to believe there's something weird going on here. So we're going to continue. Chris, I want to get your thoughts on this. JD, I want to get your thoughts on this. And we will take your calls coming up next on the other side of the break. If you want to be a part of this program, 702-257-5396. Again, that number to call. What do you think about that? Congresswoman Dina Titus, they haven't given them any information on specific targets, on the so-called imminent threat. No targets given out, no dates, nothing. What do you think about that? Give us a call, 702-257-5396. Again, that number to call, 257-5396. We will absolutely discuss this on the other side of the break. We will also take your calls on this and continue this conversation. The conversation we just had with Dina Titus, your thoughts on that as well. Again, 702-257-5396. Take a break. Be back right after this. You're listening to the Vegas Take right here on the all-new 101.5 FM, 720 AM, KDON.